Hello everyone, how are you all? Fine, so it's been a long day already. I won't take much of your time. So Manish gracefully explained how human language is layered and highly complex and how we are, you know, somehow approaching towards the level that we can finally make machines understand how we speak. You know, when we speak in normal terms, let's take an example. I will go to the cinema, or I am going to the cinema. So how usually we write in texts, I'm gonna go to a movie theater, I'm gonna go there, I'm gonna do this. So this makes sense to the person who knows you, who has been in contact with you. But to the machine, it is completely new. You have to train it on another set of data where we have slangs in there, we have every sort of, you know, type of thing that we speak. We normally talk. Okay, so as Mr. Shaila said, that in this world, there are two types of people. In my opinion as well, there are two types of people. One are data scientists and others, those who are not. Right? We can speak the language of zero and one, and the others can visualize, they can only, you know, grasp the things that we tell them. So suppose you build a model that is able to detect faces and do all that. So it won't matter to anyone or to the end stakeholder if they are not able to use it in their business. If what you have built or what you have created does not meet the expectations of the end stakeholder, it is not going to, you know, matter to them. We can build, you know, we have already built like huge models, like the BERT large has 380 million parameters and all of that. You go in and you say that in front of the stakeholder, like, I have implemented BERT and I have used this and I have used this. They'll say, so what? So let's move on to my presentation. News or read news or go through news daily. So probably we live in a fast moving world, so we do not have enough time to go through, you know, a single source from multiple platforms or from multiple data sources. And as of today, the news channels have become biased, right? One channel writes about the pros, the other channel writes about the cons, and the summarized version that you get is biased somehow. So what we are trying to do here, we are trying to, you know, grab data from every source available and trying to, you know, create a summarized version that actually is not biased or some way better than what you read through one source of data. So for this, as Manish explained in a very graceful way, like how the transformers have been introduced in the natural language processing and how BERT algorithm works and all those transformers work. So what I'll talk more on the implementation part, like how we can implement this or how we have already implemented this in our project and is already in the alpha stage. So here are the list of contents in which I have divided my talk into. So firstly, we'll be talking about the objective. Like before we started actually working on the project, what were our goals, what we set out to do, then the solution overview, how our solution came to be, and what were the steps involved in that as well. So solution objective, our objective was to identify, you know, important events that are going around in the world or that may occur in the upcoming future, and how they are going to impact our lives and what other effects they may produce. So the solution would identify such events automatically and then would generate a summarized version after, you know, scraping all the data regarding it from the net, from various search engines with the help of multiple data platforms, other data sources, and things like that. So other than just finding out the important events, it will also categorize them. So, you know, you belong to a part or you are in the Ministry of Defense. So you are basically concerned with the security events, like what are the security issues that may occur in a particular event? Like, for example, let's take the example of Expo 2020, which is going to be held in Dubai. And there are a lot of things that go into building such a successful event like this MLDS. There have been, you know, the planning starts from way beyond. People start talking about a month before or even 2 months before. You know, blogs come up and people start talking on Twitter and all that. So this was the objective of our solution. Like, we would be building this and our final goal was this. We had no plan as of yet, like how we would go on to doing this. So this was the final result. You know, as this project is still in alpha stage, these slides or these are just placed. They may or they might not, may not be placeholders. This is what the final dashboard looks like as of now. So as you can see, there are the trending events that are being displayed, like Expo Dubai 2020 and Kite Festival India, Art Deco Miami, and a single event can be categorized into multiple categories. Like Expo 2020 can have security features, medicals, and weather, and economics, and all of that. Like, there can be multiple categories related to an event. So what we did is we decided on an event, like let's grab data about Expo 2020. The data was collected and it was categorized as well and put into different categories for the final stakeholders to view. So this is how we selected events or topics that may be of importance or may actually impact our daily lives. We built custom crawlers that used to monitor, you know, top sites or around the world, top websites, blog sites like Reuters and Business Insider, etc. And what they do, they take out the latest headlines, you know, what the news channels are talking about. So if we take a topic, let's say, for example, let's say Kite Festival. So major websites in India are talking about the Kite Festival, it means that event holds value to people. You know, people are interested in it and people can actually be impacted by it, or there may be some hidden patterns, some hidden issues in it which the people might want to know about. So what our crawlers do, they take out the headlines from these channels and they match them. You know, the similarity between sentences. But the challenge here is, one channel might write the headline in some other way, another channel might write it in some other way. So this is where the BERT comes into play, you know, for sentence similarity and all that. Earlier approaches used to have lexical dictionaries. They were dependent upon, you know, the way the sentence was written, from left to right, and they are matching keywords, like if this word occurs here, and the next word occurs here, so they must be similar or they must be, something. But what BERT does, it contextually understands the sentence. It tries to understand the context behind the sentence and not just simply, you know, depending upon the order the words are arranged in. So once we select an event or our crawlers find something similar on all the websites, that particular event is marked as an important event. Now, when an event has been marked as important, the next step is to grab data about it, to scrap data about it from multiple data sources. So here we take the leverage of Google search engine and DuckDuckGo, etc. For, you know, we ran that event over the browser, you know, over the search engine. We grab data. This is all an automated process. The crawlers look for data for those keywords with the help of these search engines. And all of this occurs in the background. You know, so this means at the same time, multiple events can be analyzed simultaneously. The data is being collected simultaneously for multiple events. Now when the data is collected, you might have 1,000 articles regarding one event. Then what you would do, to, you know, grab to extract the most important details from that paragraph. If manually speaking, there are, you know, some universities, there are research scholars which do this manually. They read through multiple articles and then they form a summarized version out of it. What our model does here is it reads through entire articles, all the articles that it has gained. It matches the context, it grabs the context out of it and creates a summarized version. This is known as extractive text summarization. You know, like when you search something on Google, like when was George Bush born? So what you expect in return is the exact date. You do not want some hyperlinks to go to that link or to that link. What you want is the exact result. That is extractive text summarization. What you should note here is the model does not grab a month from one website or date from one website and then compile it together. It finds the day, it finds the exact date in one article only. You know, so it read through multiple articles available on the web, and from all those articles, it chose one. From that particular article, it extracted out the date. So this is what our model does. It reads through thousands of articles, and whatever it finds contextually related with each other, it pulls it out. So this is how we create summaries of thousands of articles related to an event. Now, why BERT? As I explained earlier, there were before the models that used to exist, they had lexical dictionaries. They used to maintain a list, or let's say this room contains, you all are words. Like, let's take an example. There is a vector space, 1D, 2D, and 3D. There are words in it, like a dog is related to cat somehow, a cat is related to a rat somehow, and they are differentiated by a distance. So a dog is farther away from a cat, but a cat is closer to a lion. Do you understand the context behind it? Like a lion is closer to a cat, but both of them are farther away from a dog. So this is how we used to, you know, work with the previous models, previous algorithms used to work on this approach. But with Google's BERT, we have BERT embeddings and all of that. So Google, the BERT uses a technique known as masked LM. What it does is, so it has a, so BERT basically stands for bidirectional encoder representations from transformers. So Manish explained transformers already, I do not want to get into that. So taking the most important points, a transformer works on two things, an encoder and a decoder. Here what an encoder does, it reads through the text and hides 75% of the data. Masked LM technique, what it does, see, you have a text as an input, it hides some of its characters from the final output. So the job of the decoder is to predict that particular word which has been hidden. So this is how the BERT algorithm learns the context of the sentences and not just go for after the order the word has been arranged in. So this is the part I'm most excited with. So how many of you know about knowledge graphs? Okay, I see quite a few hands. So what knowledge graphs are, we try to connect different entities with each other. We try to, here what we are doing, we are trying to come up with an approach with which we can connect an entity to one another and, you know, form a computer's memory, a machine's memory. So let's say I met you today and I talked with you for a while. You next day I went somewhere else and I talked with some other people. So what I did here, I met a few of you entities like A, B, C, D, E, and you met with me X. So in my memory, what we are doing, we are creating a graph. Like suppose I am X here and I have been connected to A, B, C. So if few years later, a few months later, you hear the name X, and you remember that X has been somehow related to A, B, and C. So you will immediately know my relation with A, B, and C. Like, take an example of Elon Musk. Suppose a name comes, Elon Musk, and Elon Musk is related to Tesla. So now what my system knows, Elon Musk, Tesla. They both are related in some way. And sometime after or somewhere, the model comes across an article. It reads Elon Musk is the CEO of SpaceX. So now what our model does, it links Elon Musk with both Tesla and SpaceX. So indirectly, Tesla and SpaceX are linked as well. So this is how we are forming relations. And when our model does its job, you know, it is daily going through thousands of articles, learning, grabbing together from that event. What role does that event play in case of securities or anything? So what one aspect of the future possibilities or one example of how this system can work is automated disaster prevention. As we can see, there has been an accident on the road. And similarly, okay, let's not go with this example. I have when, you know, other one. You know, in foreign countries, when there is an accident some distance off, they stop the vehicles far behind, or they delay them, that they automatically relay the information behind that there has been accident, the route has been diverted. This is what we are trying to build here. Like immediate, there is, you know, information is being sent from one point A to point B instantly, and actions are taken immediately. Now, let's talk about smart civic management. In the coming future, when we talk about smart cities and all that, what we think or what we plan to do is make the amenities easily accessible to people. You know, if there is, you know, some shortage of water, or there has been a pothole in the road, or, you know, there has been accident, what we want is to immediately provide facilities to the people, those who are in need. So what we can do, here is just a small example. The street lights have sensors here. Each street light has sensors, which relays information to the central database. As it is an example of a smart city, there has been established a data center to which all these sensors are connected. And when one of these light goes dark or stops working, immediately a signal is sent back to the data warehouse, and you know, a response is sent back. So in the coming, for when, you know, in the future times when we have enough resources to, you know, build such things, build smart lights and build all that, we can, you know, we are moving too fast, right? 300-400 years ago, we thought we were the center of the universe. And now we are here building such great things, and, you know, that goes beyond what we had hoped, you know, a decade ago. So such things, when you see, we build a thing and we build another thing. The main thing that we should focus on is combining them both to generate the maximum output. If I create a face detection model, what good would it do if it cannot, you know, be connected to a response? I'm working on point A, but there is nothing behind it. That is not going to work. So when we build something, or when we, you know, invent something, when we think, we should think big. And we should think how our solution can actually help people, how it can actually improve us. So thank you.